من يهد الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له ولا حول ولا قوة إلا بالله العلي العظيم وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن سيدنا ومولانا وعظيمنا وزعيمنا وحبيبنا محمدا صلى الله عليه وسلم قد بلغ الرسالة وأدى الأمانة ونصح الأمة وكشف الغمة وجاهد في سبيل دينه حتى أتاه اليقين فاللهم اجزه عنا وعن والدينا وعن الإسلام والمسلمين خير ما جازيت به نبيا عن قومه ورسولا عن أمته اللهم أحينا على سنته وأمتنا على ملته واحشرنا تحت لوائه وأوردنا حوضه واسقنا من يده الشريفة شربة هنيئة لا نظمأ بعدها أبدا اللهم آمين. We're continuing to cover the different aspects of good manners with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We've covered several aspects in the past few weeks, and we're continuing on the subject because it is very important to live a life of respect. Respect to Allah and appreciation of His Majesty and glorification for Him subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we cannot live this life until we understand what it means to have good manners and what are good manners like to have with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and how to exhibit these good manners with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Today we are going to focus on the contract that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has set with us where He says, فَذْكُرُونِي أَذْكُرْكُمْ Remember me so that I remember you. In the Hadith Qudsi, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, مَنْ ذَكَرَنِي فِي مَلَئٍ ذَكَرْتُهُ فِي مَلَئٍ خَيْرٍ مِّن مَلَئِهِ Anyone who mentions me, remembers me in a gathering, I will remember him and mention him in a gathering that is better than his. How good are our gatherings compared to the surrounding of Allah? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is surrounded with angels who serve His will all the time. يَفْعَلُونَ مَا يُؤْمَرُونَ لَا يَعْصُونَ اللَّهَ مَا أَمَرَهُمْ وَيَفْعَلُونَ مَا يُؤْمَرُونَ They always execute the will of Allah and they never disobey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So we have to remember that the premise and the primary principle of our relationship is He would not remember us unless we remember Him. So many of us unfortunately waste our time asking Allah and remembering that what we need when we remember Allah, but we do not actually remember Him, not when He speaks to us, not when He orders us, not when He gives us prohibitions that protect us from us and from our actions, our thoughts, our behaviors. So we need to expand our horizon and understanding of remembering Allah to be something more than the usual what you may call lip service remembrance. What is lip service remembrance? There is no Muslim who does not mention the name of Allah. Everybody does that, but the dhikr, the remembrance of Allah that actually matters is one that only is spoken as it is reflected from the heart, from the love of your heart, when you mention Allah and you mean it. Let us take some examples. When we eat and say Bismillah in the name of Allah, right? Do we really mean it? Do we think about it? That this gift of provision and food is not only given to us by Allah, but it was made for us by Allah. أَأَنْتُمْ تَزْرَعُونَهُ أَمْ نَحْنُ الزَّارِعُونَ Do you grow it up or are we the ones who grow it up? You just sow the seed, but who grows the seed for you? So we need to remember that, and part of connecting your children to Allah is to remind them of Allah in every turn and every corner. Whenever they get something, remind them that it is from Allah, it is created by Allah, and it is made by Allah for us. Allah makes things for us, and He never stops making new things. We keep discovering things that we didn't know before, from cures to disease, to things that are embedded and buried in the earth, to things that we discover in the skies, to things that we discover about ourselves, how we think, what our motives are. All of these are gifts from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So we need to remember Allah as He is the giver of all of the gifts we have. وَمَا بِكُم مِّن نِعْمَةٍ فَمِنَ اللَّهِ. Whatever you have of blessings is from whom? Allah. So when you get something new, say what? Alhamdulillah. And when you say Alhamdulillah, you better mean it. Not just make it a lip service. It is like when you give a child something, then he takes it and runs away. And then his mom or dad tells him, honey, why don't you tell uncle thank you? So he comes back and says thank you. And he goes. That is a child's way of expressing thank you, because he is too busy with the toy to thank you. He is too busy with the gift to even consider thanking the giver. With Allah, we have to act like mature, grown-up adults. We should not act like children. Keep getting and forgetting. And expect Allah to keep giving and forgiving. We have to cross this child's attitude with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that when He gives, we say Alhamdulillah. When He takes away, we also say Alhamdulillah. Because when He takes something away, He is only taking either something you don't need, or something He will give you a replacement for it, or something that may hurt you. He never takes anything that is good for you. Whatever is good, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives it to you. But that assumes that our relationship with Allah is a peaceful one, where we don't accuse Allah of what is wrong, as unfortunately some of us do all the time. When we lose something, we turn to Allah to question His wisdom. Why did you do this to me? Am I not good enough? What should I do with the prayer I pray to you? All of those types of questions of resentment and questions of refusal to accept His qada and His qadr, that what He decides for us is the best that there could be. But when we accept Him as Allah and treat Him as such, our hearts, our tongues, all of our body, all of our feelings will be full of His praise. And then and only then we will be in harmony with the rest of His creation. Because all of the creations of Allah are living by this rule. They remember Allah, and Allah always attends to them. Everything there is. Take the example. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, لو تتقوا الله حق تقاته لرزقكم كما يرزق لو توكلتم على الله حق توكله لرزقكم كما يرزق الطير. If you truly trust and rely on Allah to provide for you, He would provide for you as He does for the birds. How does He provide for the birds? The Prophet says, تغدو خماصا. They get out of their nests hungry, empty stomach. وَتَعُودُ بِطَانَا. And they come back to the nest full stomach. Who provided for them? Who told them where to go, what to pick, where to find it, and how to find it? Amazing. Amazing. Allah, who taught the birds and the animals where to find His rizq that is made ready for them, He also provided us with more capacity to find our way to earn halal rizq. Why do we then, or many or some of us, go to find what is haram, and then they come and ask, Sheikh, is this haram or halal? We know that it is haram. Once we're asking, most probably we know that it is haram. Once you start asking a question of haram and halal, it means that you have doubt about its legitimacy, its legality, its lawfulness. So think again and you will find the answer inside your heart. Most probably, your answer is good enough. But many of us, because they want to cross the bridge of halal to haram or something makruh or in between, we want to ask and let the sheikh take the responsibility for what he says. Allah taught the animal, what is right and what is wrong. If you have ever dealt with cats, a cat, when you give it food, it jumps on your lap, it rubs against you by way of thanking you for feeding her, and she feels peaceful. But when a cat steals something from the kitchen, where does she go? She doesn't come on your lap. She goes under the kitchen table or the kitchen sink or somewhere, right? So you have to understand that it is not lost on Allah that you know in your heart of hearts what is right and what is wrong. This is what is called fitrah. Fitrah. It is your nature to know and feel what is right and what's wrong. In another hadith, the Prophet ﷺ says, الْإِثْمُ مَا حَاكَ فِي الصَّدْرِ وَخَشِيْتَ أَنْ يَطَّلِعَ عَلَيْهِ النَّاسِ. One sign to know what is right and what's wrong is that what is wrong is always something that itches in your heart and you feel very worried lest anybody would know or see what you have in your heart. So you hide it. So anything that you hide, most probably you're not proud for people to see you doing it. So we have to be careful that remembering Allah is not just by mouth or by tongue. It is to remember Him in your head and to get the reference from your heart. The reference for what is right and what is wrong is embedded in your heart. This is where the fitrah is. It is fitrat Allah التي فطر الناس عليها صبغة الله ومن أحسن من الله صبغة. It is the dye that Allah has dyed us in the beginning of our creation. Then we keep washing it away or keep replacing it with other things. So Allah gives us a cover, a shield, a clothing, a cloak of taqwa, a cloak of love, a cloak of respect, clothing that protects us. But then we take it off and we end up being exposed to the shaitan running after us like a hungry, thirsty animal who's looking for food, and he takes from us. So اذكروني اذكركم is also a relationship that the Quran shows us how serious it is. Some people, unfortunately, when you start talking about Islam, Quran, Allah, the Prophet said this, the Prophet said that, they say, oh, is everything deen? Is everything deen? I warn those people, and please communicate that warning in the Quran. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَإِذَا ذُكِرَ اللَّهُ وَحْدَهُ اشْمَأَزَّتْ قُلُوبُ الَّذِينَ لَا يُؤْمِنُونَ بِالْآخِرَةِ وَإِذَا ذُكِرَ الَّذِينَ مِنْ دُونِهِ إِذَا هُمْ يَسْتَبْشِرُونَ. Those people who don't believe in the hereafter, the Quran says, when Allah alone is mentioned, their hearts become tight and resentful, rebellious. But when others are mentioned or referenced, they are very happy and open and full of ears and ready to listen and ready to follow. So you say, Rousseau said this, Bertrand Russell said that, Brian Shaw said that, they listen because it is philosophy, it is something that they can repeat and say. So they are not good with the Quran, they are not good with the Sunnah, so they want to be able to quote all others but Allah, because they have not grown up to love Allah. They have resentment towards Allah. فَاذْكُرُونِي أَذْكُرْكُمْ. Remember me, so that I remember you. What should we remember about Allah? Of course, we should remember His holy names and His glorious attributes, subhanahu wa ta'ala. When should we remember it? Well, actually, we have a very good system. When we want to make dua, we ask Allah in His holy names for what we want. Ya Rahman, Ya Rahim, give us this, do this to us. So we are very good when we want something. But when we think we don't, then we even act as if we never know Him, as if we never knew Allah. So Shaykh, what do I say if I want to pray to Allah? Say anything you want. Call Him by any names you remember. But don't call Him with a name that is fictitious or that gives Him description or quality like His creation. He is Allah. He is unique. هو الله الذي لا إله إلا هو. It is He, Allah, who is unique, and there is no God but He, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. ليس كمثله شيء. There is nothing like unto Him. وهو السميع البصير. يا سميع يا بصير. اللهم اسمع دعاءنا. اللهم انظر لنا بعين رحمتك. Those are the names and other names that we should call Allah. ولله الأسماء الحسنى فدعوه بها. Allah has His holy names and glorious attributes. Call Him in His holy names. O Allah, by Your name, You are the Jabbar, You are the Qahhar. O Allah, destroy those earthly Jabbareen, earthly tyrants, destroy them. You're calling Him by the powerful name to meet those who claim His qualities, claim His power, and steal it. So we need to ask ourselves, do we remember Allah often enough? Do we remember Allah? Do we remember what He gives us and what He protects us against? Do we remember what He gave us when we had nothing, when we were nothing? هل أتى على الإنسان حين من الدهر لم يكن شيئا مذكورا. Has there ever come a time for man when he was nothing to mention, nothing to remember? Nothing. We were nothing. Remember Allah when you were nothing and He turned you into the man or the woman you are. He gave you السمع والأبصار والأفئدة لعلكم تشكرون. He gave you the hearing, the sight, and the heart so that you may remember Him and be grateful to Him. So when we remember Allah, do we remember Him only to scare our children? He's going to do this, He's going to do that, He's going to destroy this, He's going to put you to this punishment. Or do we remember Allah in the proper way that we use His name only when things matter and warrant that we mention His name? Many of us use the name of Allah to swear right and left. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَاحْفَظُوا أَيْمَانَكُمْ. Keep your swearing to yourself. Don't keep swearing. And the more people swear, the less they keep their commitment. وَلَا تُطِعْ كُلَّ حَلَّافٍ مَهِينٍ. Don't follow anyone whose habit is continuous swearing. بجد والله والله العظيم والله العظيم ثلاثة أقسم بالله العظيم. All of these swearings, Allah doesn't need it. That is not the way to mention Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Many of the people who use this method, they are hiding their lies behind their constant and continuous swearing. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made a kafara for false swearing. كفارة اليمين. فكفارته إطعام عشرة مساكين من أوسط ما تطعمون به أهليكم أو كسوتهم أو تحرير رقبة. Three serious compensation or expiations that you have to pay. Serious charge. that you swear and you know that you are lying. But what is most serious is the punishment. The punishment. وَاجْتَنِبُوا قَوْلَ الزُّورِ. Avoid false talk. Avoid false swearing. What is the punishment? Hellfire. Hellfire. So we have to be careful that we do not use the name of Allah at whim, but we use it with respect, with appreciation. When you invoke the name of Allah, you have to have appreciation in your heart and understanding of the potential consequences of mentioning Allah or invoking His name wrongly. Then we come to other ways in which we mention Allah, but we do not mean it absolutely. I'll give you a very serious example that many of us are engaged in on a daily basis. When we get married, and the father of the bride says to the groom, I give you my daughter in marriage on the foundation of the book of Allah and the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the traditions of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Do we really watch what we're saying? Do we really follow through with this kind of commitment? Do we really take the Quran and the sunnah as the true foundation on which we build our family life and the rest of our life? Or are we just saying it as a matter of ceremony? It's a ceremonial statement. You just say it to get through the contract, but in reality, neither do you mean it, nor do you watch what you say, nor do you want to apply it. And the evidence is, when we get married, as soon as we get married, in fact, we start treating each other in a way that is very inconsistent with the commitment we made in the beginning. So that is a remembrance or mentioning of Allah when it is not absolutely meant, because it has nothing in reality with what we actually turn out doing, which is violating every word. Number one, we do not even study the book on which we are saying we are going to build our family life. So how is it that we want to actually build this family institution, the most important institution in society, on no foundation? No, we say, no, we have the foundation, it is the Quran and the Sunnah. But in reality, we're trying to build on no foundation, or shaky foundation. So we neither study the Quran, as far as it relates to family life, nor do we admit when reminded of what the Quran says about family and how it ought to be run. So that is mentioning of Allah that we do not mean, we do not implement, and it puts us in a position of rebellion against Allah. You're just invoking His name, thinking that invoking His name, invoking His book, will turn this marriage into legitimate and halal, irrespective of how much we violate the book, how much we violate the sunnah. It doesn't work this way. You make a commitment with any human being and they catch you and tell you, this is your contract. Item 7, you're not complying. Item 2, you're not complying. We have to break the contract. I'm not satisfied. Allah, on the other hand, keeps giving us chances after chances to reconsider, to remember. وَاذْكُرُوا نِعْمَةَ اللَّهِ عَلَيْكُمْ وَمِيثَاقَهُ الَّذِي وَثَقَكُمْ بِهِ. Remember Allah and His bounties and the covenant that He has taken from you. What is the covenant? The covenant is to care fully for your dependents as you care for yourself. And when those dependents are weak and vulnerable, then you give them more care than yourself and before you give yourself. That becomes exercising responsibility and making good on our promise that we build this family on the foundation of the Quran and the Sunnah. Otherwise, remembering Allah doesn't mean lip service. Remembering Allah doesn't mean counting how many times you say Alhamdulillah, Subhanallah, as quick as you can and get it over with. It is not a chore that you want to get to the finish line of. It is a relationship. It is, in fact, a way of life. So knowledge of Allah doesn't help when we need it and then we forget to remember Allah, because if you forget Allah when you need Him the most, the knowledge He taught you is going to be taken away. So it is like somebody who knows everything what to do about his car. He got stuck in the highway and the first thing he does is call a mechanic. Do you know what? You are a mechanic. He is a mechanic. Instead of checking his car, he is calling for someone. Brothers, we have to be careful that remembering Allah is a relationship. It goes beyond that we only talk to Him when it is a crisis. We only talk to Him when we are sick. We only talk to Him when we get fired or terminated. We only talk to Him when we lose a child. That is not the way a Muslim structures his or her relationship with Allah. There are other people who live like this. وَمِنَ النَّاسِ مَنْ يَعْبُدُ اللَّهَ عَلَى حَرْفٍ. Some people worship Allah and their relationship with Allah is one that is standing on edge, on a sharp edge. فَإِنْ أَصَابَهُ خَيْرٌ اطْمَأَنَّ بِهِ. If he is given something good, he is happy, he is stable, he is comfortable. وَإِنْ أَصَابَتْهُ فِتْنَةٍ انْقَلَبَ عَلَى وَجْهِهِ. When he is tested or afflicted, he turns on his face. خَسِرَ الدُّنْيَا وَالْآخِرَةِ ذَلِكَ هُوَ الْخُسْرَانُ الْمُبِينَ. He loses this life and the hereafter by losing his relationship with Allah. Some people, when they are in trouble, they mention and remember Allah earnestly. But when it is done, they go back to their old habits. حتى إذا كنتم في الفلك وجرين بهم بريح طيبة وفرحوا بها جاءتها ريح عاصف وجاءهم الموج من كل مكان وظنوا أنهم أحيط بهم دعوا الله. Some would be on a ship and the sail is nice and the wind is running their way and they are happy and comfortable and in celebratory mode. Then it turns, waves get high, winds become gusty, and they know that they are most probably gone. They are finished. Then they pray to Allah and say, "Oh Allah, save us only this time. لَئِنْ أَنْجَيْتَنَا مِنْ هَذِهِ لَنَكُونَنَّ مِنَ الشَّاكِرِينَ." I want you to remember, they are saying, if you save us from this one, means what? They had it before, right? But this time they want to pretend that they are serious. Save us from this one. فَلَمَّا أَنْجَاهُمْ مِنْهَا. And when they ask, they say, لَنَكُونَنَّ مِنَ الشَّاكِرِينَ. They are not saying, we will give you gratitude. سَنَكُونُ سَنَشْكُرُكْ. No, they are saying, we will join those who live a life of gratitude. We will be among them. We will be in the midst of them. لَنَكُونَنَّ مِنَ الشَّاكِرِينَ. Which means, we will turn our life around to please you and to show you how grateful and appreciative we are. لَنَكُونَنَّ مِنَ الشَّاكِرِينَ. فَلَمَّا أَنْجَاهُمْ مِنْهَا إِذَا هُمْ يَبْغُونَ فِي الْأَرْضِ بِغَيْرِ الْحَقِّ. When he saves them, they turn tyrants and rebellion and repressive against Allah and against His creation. يَا أَيُّهَا النَّاسِ إِنَّمَا بَغْيُكُمْ عَلَىٰ أَنفُسِكُمْ مَتَاعَ الْحَيَاةِ الدُّنْيَا. Your tyranny and rebellion is only against you. It's a matter of utility for this life. You can use the power that Allah has given you for anything, good or bad. It's up to you. But then you will return back to Allah. ثُمَّ إِلَيْنَا مَرْجِعُكُمْ فَنُنَبِّئُكُمْ بِمَا كُنْتُمْ تَعْمَلُونَ. We'll get you back. And when Allah says, we will get you back, you better watch what's going to happen. It's a threat. From whom? From Allah. So we have to remember Allah the way He ought to be remembered. Not only when it is difficult, not only when it is a crisis, not only when somebody dies or there is a calamity or volcano or earthquake or anything like that. We ought to remember Allah and all the time, when it's good, when it's bad. The Prophet ﷺ summarizes the attitude of the believer in a hadith in which he says, عَجَبًا لِأَمْرِ الْمُؤْمِنِ إِنَّ أَمْرَهُ كُلَّهُ لَهُ خَيْرٌ. The matter of the believer is amazing. It is all good for him. إِنْ أَصَابَتْهُ سَرَّاءَ شَكَرَ فَكَانَ خَيْرًا لَهُ وَإِنْ أَصَابَتْهُ ضَرَّاءَ صَبَرَ فَكَانَ خَيْرًا لَهُ وَلَيْسَ ذَلِكَ لِأَحَدٍ إِلَّا لِلْمُؤْمِنِ. If he's given something good, he is grateful, and this is good for him. And when he is tested, tried, or afflicted, he is patient, and this is good for him. And this, meaning this attitude, is only true for the believer. وَلَيْسَ ذَلِكَ لِأَحَدٍ إِلَّا لِلْمُؤْمِنِ. اللهم اجعلنا من المؤمنين، واجعلنا من الشاكرين، واجعلنا من الصابرين، واجعلنا من الذاكرين. الحمد لله وكفى، والصلاة والسلام على عباده الذين اصطفى، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله، وأشهد أن سيدنا ولانا محمدا عبده ورسوله. وبعد، from the hadith we mentioned last time, one of the rights of Allah سبحانه وتعالى on His servants is to be remembered and to never be forgotten. أن يذكر فلا ينسى. And the biggest mistake that any human could do that may lead to his full destruction, both in this life and in the hereafter, is to forget Allah. وَلَا تَكُونُ كَالَّذِينَ نَسُوا اللَّهَ فَأَنْسَاهُمْ أَنفُسَهُمْ. Don't you be like the people or those who forgot Allah or neglected Allah, and Allah would make them forget themselves. So some people think that they are doing well. They are good with money, they are good with business, they are good with this, they are good with that. But they don't know that all of this can turn against them, both in this life and in the hereafter. Because it is your relationship with Allah that stands to protect you in this life and in the hereafter. Before you get to your bank, Allah is the one who provides. Before you go home, it is Allah who gifted you with this family. Before you get to your career, Allah is the one who facilitated this job opportunity. Before you lose your job, Allah has a plan for you for the next one. So it is not your boss. It is not the money in your bank. It is not the family at home. It is not your husband. It is not your spouse. It is not your child. It is not your parent. It is Allah and your relationship with Him that is your ultimate source of security. How come we forget the ultimate and go after anything secondary? How do we do that? Because we are living a life that is full of distractions. Even in our prayer, we get distracted. Even in our fasting, we get distracted. In everything in this life is a distraction. And that's why there is a huge emphasis on warning us against those distractions. Allah describes this whole life with everything it has as a game and a set of toys. إِنَّمَا هَذِهِ الْحَيَاةُ الدُّنْيَا لَهُونَ وَلَعِبٌ وَزِينَةٌ وَتَفَاخُرٌ وَتَكَاثُرٌ بَيْنَكُمْ فِي الْأَمْوَالِ وَالْأَوْلَادِ كمثل زرع أعجب الكفار نباته ثم يهيج فتراه مصفرا ثم يكون حطاما وفي الآخرة عذاب شديد ومغفرة من الله ورضوان وما الحياة الدنيا إلا متاع الغرور. This life is only a toy. It's a game. It's a pleasure. It's a joy. But only for الغرور. Who is الغرور? الشيطان. الغرور is الشيطان. الشيطان is the one who uses everything in this life to deceive us. And that's why he's called الغرور. وَلَا يَغُرَّنَّكُمْ بِاللَّهِ الْغَرُورِ الشيطان. Let not the shaitan distract you from remembering Allah and from living a godly life. وَلَكِنْ كُونُوا رَبَّانِيِّينَ. Be you godly, which means attached to your Lord, attached to Allah, living His way, making things His way. Then you become His. You become Rabbani. You become godly. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us all the guidance we need and help us learn it and help us apply it. اللهم اهدنا فيمن هديت وعافنا فيمن عافيت وتولنا فيمن توليت وقنا واصرف عنا شر ما قضيت. اللهم قنا واصرف عنا شر ما قضيت. اللهم خذ بأيدينا إليك أخذ الكرام عليك. اللهم احفظنا بحفظك يا أرحم الراحمين واكلأنا بركنك يا أرحم الراحمين. اللهم اغفر لنا ذنوبنا وإسرافنا في أمرنا وثبت أقدامنا وانصرنا على القوم الكافرين. اللهم لا تدع لنا في يومنا هذا ذنبا إلا غفرته ولا دينا إلا قضيته ولا كربا إلا نفسته ولا هما إلا فرجته ولا أسيرا إلا فككته ولا مجاهدا إلا نصرته ولا ظالما لمسلم إلا قصمته. اللهم عليك بالجبارين. اللهم عليك بالجبارين. اللهم عليك بالطغاة الجبارين فإنهم لا يعجزونك يا رب العالمين. اللهم يا منتقم يا جبار. اللهم انتقم لكل مظلوم. اللهم انتصر للمظلومين وانتصر للمستضعفين في كل مكان يا أرحم الراحمين. اللهم أعزنا بالإسلام وأعز الإسلام بنا واجعل الإسلام قرة أعيننا. اللهم اجعل القرآن ربيع قلوبنا وشفاء صدورنا وجلاء همومنا وأحزاننا. اللهم ذكرنا منه ما نسينا وعلمنا منه ما جهلنا وانفعنا بما علمتنا واجعله قرة أعيننا في الدنيا والآخرة. اللهم اجعل القرآن لنا نورا في حياتنا ونورا في قبورنا ونورا على الصراط ونورا حين نلقاك. اللهم شفعه فينا يا أرحم الراحمين. اللهم اجعلنا من أهل القرآن الذين هم أهلك وخاصتك. اللهم اختم لنا بخاتمة السعادة أجمعين واحشرنا مع النبيين والصديقين والشهداء والصالحين ومثل ذلك لآبائنا وعلمائنا وأمهاتنا ولكل من له حق علينا. اللهم اهد شباب المسلمين واهد نساء المسلمين واهد رجال المسلمين إلى الصراط المستقيم. أقول قولي هذا وأستغفر الله لي ولكم ولسائر المؤمنين والمؤمنات من كل ذنب. أقم الصلاة إن الصلاة تنهى عن الفحشاء والمنكر ولذكر الله أكبر والله يعلم ما تصنعون.